Acts of the Apostles, chapter 16. The book of Acts, chapter 16. If I may read from verse 13. Acts chapter 16, reading from verse 13. And on the Sabbath he went out of the city by a riverside, where prayer was wont to be made. And he sat down and spake unto the women which resorted thither. And a certain woman named Lydia, a seller of purple, of the city of Thyatira, which worshipped God, heard us, whose heart the Lord opened, that she attended unto the things which were spoken of God. And when she was baptized and her household, she besought us, saying, If ye have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come into my house and abide there. And she constrained us. And it came to pass, as we went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with the spirit of divination met us, which brought her masters much pain by soothsaying. The same followed on and asked and cried, saying, These men are the servants of the Most High God, which show unto us the way of salvation. And did she many days, but Paul, being grieved, turned and said to the Spirit, I command thee in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. And he came out the same hour. And when her masters saw that the hope of their gains was gone, they caught Paul and Silas and threw them into the marketplace unto the rulers, and brought them to the magistrate, saying, These men being Jews do exceedingly trouble our city, and teach customs which are not lawful for us to receive, neither to observe, being Romans. And the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrates rent off their clothes and commanded to beat them. And when they had laid many stripes upon them, they cast them into prison, charging the jailer to keep them safely, who, having received such a charge, thrust them into the inner prison and made their feet fast in the stocks. And at midnight Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened, and everyone's bands were loosed. And the keeper of the prison, waking out of his sleep, and seeing the prison doors open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoners had been fled. But Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, Do thyself no harm, for we are all here. Then he called for a light and sprung in, and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas, and brought them out and said, Sirs, what must I do to be saved? And they said, Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved, and thy house. And they spake unto him the word of the Lord, and to all that were in his house. And he took them the same hour of the night, and washed their stripes, and was baptized, he and all his straightway. And when he had brought them into his house, he set meat before them, and rejoice, believing in God with all his house. May the Lord bless again the reading of his disciple. Acts chapter 16. And there are two verses, verse 30 and 31. Acts chapter 16, verse 30. And brought them out, the jailer brought them out and said, Sirs, what must I do to be saved? And they said, Paul and Silas said unto him, Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved, and thy house. So my subject tonight is the cry of a lost soul, the cry of a lost soul. And this is an amazing chapter. I have no time and I have no intention really to go into details, but it is a chapter filled with unlikely conversions, many conversions, if I may say, even a chapter of miracles. Many miracles are happening in this wonderful chapter 16 of the book of Acts. If I may just mention three of the great conversions we find in this chapter. The most obvious one, the first one, is that a seller, a purple seller, a trader, a woman, has found the Lord. And the text says, the Lord opened her heart as she hears, or as she heard, the word of the Lord Jesus Christ. The second conversion is about a young girl, a young damsel, a fortune teller possessed by a spirit of divination. She was making a lot of money for her masters, and she also has found the Lord Jesus Christ. Then we have the man who is concerning us tonight, the jailor. But it is interesting, I'm sure you don't need me to remind you this, that all the three conversions, you can see all kinds of people, men, women, young, old, they're all here. And you can see with Lydia, as the Lord opened her heart, she was saved, and her household, her servants, they heard the gospel also, and they found the Lord. Then the young damsel, she found the Lord, she repented from her sins, and instead of being a fortune teller, instead of a spirit of divination, now she was set free. Oh, there is no greater freedom. Then the jailer is also saved, we are told, with his household, certainly with his children, with his servants, but again, it's his whole family. Not that because he saved, the whole family was saved, but salvation is for individuals. Salvation is personal. So each one of them came to find the Lord as they hear the gospel being explained and preached by the apostles. So it is, as I said, an unlikely conversion. Not the people we think would have repented or would have found the Lord Jesus Christ from the beginning. But it is interesting, these people have become the first members of the local church at Philippi. The first members. So you can see there is a variety of them. Like the gospel must be preached to all creatures. All creatures. Everyone who can hear must hear the gospel in order to find and to find way to repent before the Lord and have his sins be forgiven. But my brothers and sisters, the gospel is glorious because of its simplicity, because of its clarity, because of its brevity. It is simple, but never think because it is simple it means, oh, it didn't cost anything. It is simple on our side, but it was not man-made. Man couldn't have fabricated it. Man couldn't have concocted it. There is no way. The most generous, the most intelligent man could have never thought about a way for men to be forgiven and to have their sins forgiven by somebody being crucified on a cross. Oh, this is beyond our understanding. But we understand it because God has revealed it for us in his inspired word, the Bible. That's why we preach the gospel. That's why we speak about the Bible. Or as I said, my intention is not to go in details about what's going on. But because this is a well-known text, so I will draw your attention especially on those two verses. Verse 30 and 31. They are well-known. Two verses, but in 3 points. The first one, my first point will be, oh, there was a great fear. Because of that fear, there was a very serious question. And because of that question, the apostles will give a perfect answer. So a great fear, a serious question, but also a perfect answer. 3 points as we consider this verse. But that great fear came What how? In verse 26, and we are told, and suddenly, please underline and bear in mind that word, suddenly, unexpectedly, and suddenly, there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken. This is another miracle, actually. There was a sudden earthquake, and we are told the prison was shaken. The prison was shaken, but not in debris. It was not in pieces, because normally, not long time ago, we heard about the damages of an earthquake. But this must be a local, it was localized in a specific place. It was the intervention of God that there was that earthquake. But there was the earthquake, the prison didn't fall, it crumbled and into pieces, but also the doors were open. The doors were open, the chains of the prisoners were released, but no prisoner decamped, no prisoner escaped. They stayed there. But actually, the first thing a prisoner will want is to escape. But miraculously, everything was there for everyone to escape, but a miracle after a miracle. So I believe the jailer was gripped with fear, as we are told in the text itself, verse 26, 27, and the keeper of the prison awakened out of his sleep and seeing the prison doors open. So the prison doors were open, the chains were released, and the prisoners, but another miracle, the prisoners are there, instead of leaving the place. So awakened with a start, he felt that this is nothing else than the presence of God. Please do not read anything else in what was happening in the effects. The outcome of the earthquake, this man suddenly realized that this is happening, and it is happening by no other power except the power of the living God. This is how you have to look at it. And then, while there, he was answerable for his prisoners with his life. If the prisoners escape, he would be discharged and piped at the post on the next day publicly. That would happen to him, certainly. And this is why, because he knows also the outcome for himself. And in verse 28, Paul could stop him. End of verse 27, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoner had been fled. But Paul cried out with a loud voice, saying, "Do thyself no harm, for we are all here." My brothers and sisters, the jailer, because of what has happened, if the prisoners have escaped, he saw the doors open, he didn't yet realize that they didn't decamp. If he preferred to die than to fall in that great shame. When I read the text, it reminds me what Jonah said, the prophet Jonah in Jonah chapter 4. He said, "Now for me to die is better than to live." But the big question, please, I want you in your mind and in my mind also to move from what is happening to the jailer. What this has to do with us today? What can we learn from this? And I'm sure, again, you don't need me to remind you that the God, our God, the God of the Bible, and you can see that in your own life, God uses sometimes strange and hard means in order to wake us, in order to take us out from that lethargy, that spiritual lethargy. What kind of dangers God can use in order, here I am, I'm walking in the street, I'm living my own life, I'm following my career, I never thought about God, that there is God. God, why do I need God? Show me God. And so, you know, there is more. You need more faith to be an atheist than to believe in God, actually. So the dangerous God will send some fears, deep fear. This is what was happening to the jailer. Deep fear, an extreme danger facing death. He may bring failure. He may bring sickness, illness, broken relationship, bereavement, the loss of a dear one. Oh, God is sovereign. He can bring all this to happen. You know, every tragedy or event happening in your life, God brings it in order to use it as an opportunity. You are here tonight. It's not by accident. It's not by chance. It's not, oh, I decided I want to be there tonight. Yes, you may have decided. But in the overruling of God, God wanted you to be here in order to hear something which will challenge you, which will bring you to see life. Now, there is more in life than just to live purposeless, insignificant life. I have a friend. He's a pastor now. He found the Lord in an amazing way. He was in a big campus. Student living on campus, thousands and thousands of them. While he was under the shower, there was the alarm, fire alarm. And everyone, the alarm rang and everyone must leave the building. Everyone went to the meeting point. But he was under the shower. He couldn't hear the alarm. So when he came out from the shower, he checked every room. Nobody's there. Nobody's there. And this event God has used in order now. He's a nominal. He's from a Christian family, never sought and found the Lord Jesus Christ. And because he didn't see anyone, every room he knocked there, he checked, nobody's there. He said, maybe the Lord Jesus Christ came back and took everyone except him. And when he went out, and this is a true story, when he went out from that place, the only thing, and actually they came to find him in a room crying, being deeply convicted about his sinful life. We can multiply the examples. I know another pastor, his own mother put poison in the food to kill him. He's crippled now, he could hardly walk. But this event, again, he was not a believer. He was sharing the food with another brother who has found the Lord. But this brother prayed to the Lord before eating that meal. But the younger one didn't. And even today, he's crippled. And this event of being poisoned by his own mother brought him to find the Lord Jesus Christ. True story also. I know the person. That's why I'm explaining that testimony. So God can use all sorts of events, even simple things we do not consider, in order to shake us, to come back to life, and see that there is a purpose in life. We can have our sins forgiven, we can have a new nature, our heart which is hard heart, and just living for ourselves, the me, myself, I, me, myself, can be changed, and now I have relationship with the living God, and if I die tonight, I know where I'm going, I know where I'm heading, for the Lord Jesus Christ will welcome me in heaven. Because he died on the cross of Calvary for his people, those who will trust in him. So, the many dangers God can bring in the life of us, they can be economical, they can be social, they can be domestic, they can be physical, they can be spiritual. Oh, this is the, God is a God of order. Why there is harmony in this life? Why there is harmony in this world? You know, if there was no God, there would be chaos. Everyone will be a law to himself. But there is a God. That's why there is order. There is order in your house, there is order in your school, there is order in the nation. Actually, the disorder we see, do you know why there is disorder? It's because of our sinful nature. If not, the Bible tells us that when God created this universe, it was perfect. It was perfect. But sin, again, the wages of sin is death. Why do we die? This is a question many millions cannot answer. Why do we die? Bible gives us the answer. So as we come to this jailer, he was broken with that great false sleep, and God speaks. But shall we listen? Shall we learn from the things which are happening to us? Or when all hopes vanishes, when we become helpless and hopeless, This is the time God works in us and brings us on our knees, humble us to the dust, and then the only thing we can do is to cry unto Him for forgiveness. So much to be said on the fear that came, gripped the jailer. But the second point, because of that great fear now, he has a serious question. You know, this is a man who he doesn't ask questions. This is a rough Roman soldier, and Roman soldiers, they are brash, no care, no affection. And later you will see this man is transformed, he's completely changed. And that's why Paul could say to him in verse 28, Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, "Do thyself no harm, for we are all here." Then he called for a light and sprang in and came trembling. He never trembled. They are bold. And just a few hours earlier, he was menacing. He was swaggering. But now, the bold Roman soldier, the rough, callous soldier, has become a small man, trembling before. Actually, the boot is on the other feet now. The table have turned. It's not anymore Paul and Silas and the other men who are prisoners. Who is the real prisoner? Oh, the jailer became the real prisoner. And now he asks that wonderful question. What must I do to be saved? A few hours before, he was not inquiring. Such inquiry was not in his heart. But he heard, certainly. How did he come to that conclusion? How did he come to seek the Lord? Oh, certainly, he heard. I believe if this didn't just happen from nowhere. In verse 17, look at verse 17. From the young damsel, crying through many days, the same followed Paul and us and cried, saying, "These men are the servants of the Most High God, which show unto us the way of salvation." I believe he heard that. The way of salvation? What is that? And maybe in verse 25, "And at midnight Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God." That was a sacred worship that night. And we heard them with the prisoners. And in prayer, when you pray publicly, the prayers are heard, the words are heard, the hymns are heard, the praises heard. And he heard certainly about the Lord Jesus Christ, singing certainly from many psalms from the Old Testament. And those things have moved him. His conscience is found, his heart is pricked, and he couldn't stay alone. He couldn't just be indifferent to what is going on. Oh, are you indifferent, my brother and sister? Are you indifferent when you hear the gospel? This is the gospel which can save your soul, give you purpose in life, give you new name in heaven, give you new relationship with God, give you even new relationship with one another. You know, when we are converted, oh, we love not only God, but we love our neighbor also. There is a new dimension. The vertical and horizontal relationship is changed completely. So the man is completely transformed. And I don't believe, again, that this man asked the question, "What must I do to be saved?" just because he wanted to save his neck. That's not why he asked the question. Because the prisoners are there. They didn't escape. They are there. Paul would say to him, "Here, there, we are all here. Don't do any harm to yourself." But because now his conscience is deeply convicted. And he found out that he needs the forgiveness of his sins. He needs to be challenged. So trembling, he comes before Paul and Silas. "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" To be saved means to be rescued from a pending condemnation. If you have a good career, welcome for you. But our greatest need is not career, it's not ambition, it's not promotion. Our greatest need, there is no greater diploma than to leave this place tonight being forgiven. Now that leads me to the third question. He asked that question, where is the answer? Oh, there is a perfect answer. What must I do to be saved? Silas, I'm using 11 words. 11 words to take a sinner from this earth unto heaven. A sinner forgiven and made a sin. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. 11 words. Encompassing all that we need to know in order to have our sins forgiven. No, you see, you don't need intellectual academics, you don't need libraries, books and books and lectures after lectures. Just 11 words. What must I do? If that is a sincere question, it comes from your heart, it comes from your mind, and you saw yourself as a needy sinner, wretched, doomed, condemned, and there is no other way to escape the wrath of the living God, then I come as the jailer did, trembling, and he fell before Paul and Silas and said, Master, what must I do to be saved? What must I do? No, there is nothing to do. Salvation is not about doing. Salvation is about Christ dying. That's the difference. And the jailer saw his iniquity. He saw his indignity, he saw his misery, he saw his emptiness, the empty life he was living, and now he realized that there is no greater need for him than to be forgiven. Oh, what is the answer? What must I do to be saved? And Paul and Silas said unto him, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. The Lord will answer a prayer that seeks salvation. I'm just afraid to add the word always. The Lord will always answer a prayer that seeks salvation. If you mean it, if it's from your heart, if it's from the Spirit of God, and you cry unto the Lord, he will answer your prayer. And you know, the jailer was expecting a to-do list. But the gospel is simple. Not do, but believe. How different is the gospel? Believe me, you take every religion, it's a to-do list. Do this, do this, do this, do this, do that, do that, do that. And maybe, perhaps, if God will, he will accept you into heaven. But the gospel, what must I do? What is necessary for me to do to be reconciled with God? What must I do in order to enter in heaven? What must I do to receive the everlasting life? Believe. That's it. Oh, people are after complicated things, sophisticated things. Do you know, the gospel, nothing laborious, nothing complicated. That you don't need a special jargon, a special language. You don't need to be in a specific place, even in a prison. Oh, you are here, you are not in prison tonight. But this is the best place, and nothing should interfere between you and God. Only two things are necessary for a sinner to be saved. God and the sinner. No intermediary, no mediator except the Lord Jesus Christ, and no third party. If you mean it, you come to the Lord Jesus Christ, who died on the cross of Calvary to redeem sinners. Oh, the Bible says, thou shalt be saved. That's his assurance. That is certainty. Have you seen it? God will do it. I cannot do it. I wish I could. Believe me, if I can come to your heart now and pierce your heart, speak to your mind, even write your name in heaven, I will do it. But I don't have that authority. I'm afraid, fragile. Nothing. If this few words can help you to find the Lord tonight, praise be to the Lord. You don't need any specific given time, even at midnight. 7:25 now, you can find the Lord and be reconciled with him and have your sins be forgiven. Oh, yes, believe. But have you noticed something? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. My brothers and sisters, what you believe and in whom you believe is important. Many people believe in whatever. The object of your faith is important. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Yeah? We can spend the night, believe me, on those three words. Lord Jesus Christ. Lord means what? In the Greek text, when the jailer said, sirs,
says to him, no, there is no other Lord. There is only one Lord, the Lord Jesus Christ. The one who created heaven and earth. The one who dwells in heaven. The one who can take a sinner into heaven. The one who sits on the throne in heaven. The one who has received all authority in heaven and earth. The Lord of lords. There are some religions, they teach, oh, Christ was just a prophet. You see, this word Lord is not used for a mere prophet. The Lord of lords and kings of kings. That's the meaning. Believe in whom? On the Lord, the only Lord, God, who has created you. Then he says, believe on the Lord Jesus. The name Jesus is his humiliation name. Thou shalt give him the name Jesus, Matthew 1:21, for he shall save his people from their sins. So this is the man who has been sent to die on the cross to pay the price for our sins. Oh, Christ then, Christ the anointed one, that's his office. So we have his authority, his mission of atonement, paying for the sin of his people. But we have also his office. He's the only one of his kind. The word Christ means the Messiah, the anointed one, the only one of that kind, no other savior in heaven and earth. So I come to him tonight. I come to the Lord Jesus Christ. I receive the forgiveness of my sins. To believe is not to make yourself better. It's not to try hard. It's not to turn a new leaf. Some people say, oh, from tomorrow I will turn a new leaf and make myself better. Then to believe is not to understand the Bible. Of course, as you believe in the Lord's mercy, as you study the Bible, God will grant you the possibility and the capacity to understand the Bible. But don't wait until you understand the Bible. Even for us, preaching the Bible for so many years, but we still struggle to understand it. This is the printed mind of God. How could you, a feeble man, earthly man, can understand the mind of God in heaven who transcends everything, heaven and earth? But he gave us his word. You know, we believe in Christ because he gave us the Bible, 66 books to tell us what God has done for us in order to be saved. Oh, to believe is to believe in a person, not in good works. True love is always sacrificial. And Christ has shown his love unto us by coming on this world, and he has suffered and died on the cross of Calvary to take away sin of his people. To believe is to obey him. I'm explaining what it means to believe, because people ask us many times, what it means to believe? To believe, it means to obey him. When he says repent, what do you do? Oh, I sincerely repent. I have to explain again what we mean by repentance. My brothers and sisters, before I close, repentance is not to have remorse. Oh, suddenly, I regret. I have remorse. I'm grieved. That's emotional. To repent is not to have a long face, to be serious, like if you are in a grave or in a graveyard. That's not. To repent is an about face, not long face, but an about face. Oh, I turned away from my sin, and I turned to God. That's what repentance. If that has never happened in your life, Bible says you are not a child of God. Here I am going on my own way, but now I hear the gospel of redeeming grace. What must I do to be saved? And I cry, oh Lord, save me. Then the Lord Jesus Christ comes in mighty power by the Holy Spirit and change my life. The Bible is very clear, unless we repent, we shall all perish. Luke 13, verse 3. We shall all perish unless we repent. But repentance is at the door of your heart tonight. Oh, to believe means hands up. Hands up. I abdicate. I lay down my arms. Nothing to fight. I'm defeated. That's what repentance means. I come with nothing in my hands except my sins. I trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. The first time, the Lord, a cousin spoke to me about the Lord Jesus Christ. I spared him. I said, he was a foolish person, but this man prayed for me 3 years while we were still burning Bibles, nothing to do with Christians. We hated them. We did not want to meet him. But again, the Lord had mercy upon me, and he saved me from an empty life. He saved me from religion. He saved me from purposeless life. And now I know, because of Christ's sake, my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. This is the gift. It is a gift. In every culture, you don't pay for a gift. In every culture, you just receive it. You trust in the Lord. Or the time will not allow to continue to explain these things. But as I repent tonight, Christ will say, thou shall be saved. It is certainty. It is a gift. It is an assurance. It is done. You see, it is a passive tense. Thou shalt be saved. It is done. It doesn't require to pay. It doesn't require your contribution. It doesn't even require your pilgrimage. It doesn't require your prayer. The only prayer you can pray tonight, oh Lord, be merciful unto me, a wretched sinner. I repent. I trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. But as I close, can you see the changes happening in the life of this man? He's completely changed. He said, what must I do? Salvation is individual. What must I, not what must we do? It is individual and personal, but his life was completely changed from despair to delight. The persecutor became the carer. He took the apostles, he washed them, he took a towel, he provided for them. And verse 34, he was baptized, and we are told that, and he took them the same hour on the night and washed their stripes. While he was washing their stripes, their wounds, the Lord was washing his sins. Oh, what a great picture. And was baptized, he and all his straightway. So faith is not a work, but it works. It works. Faith is not a killjoy. This man was delighted. He received great joy. People say, oh, if I come to Christ, I will be miserable. No, you will not be miserable. You will be rejoiced. Things will not be smooth and easy in life, but you have the presence of the Lord. You have the presence of the Holy Spirit within you. Oh, his conviction was turned into conversion and compassion. Don't harm yourself. Don't harm your soul. Don't self-destroy yourself. Why should you die? Why should you live as a homeless while there is a refuge? Oh, come to Christ tonight. What must I do to be saved? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. Let's close our time together by singing hymn number 405. Hymn number 405.